we have Ruth Felder, who many of you will know, who's here in Toronto for a long time, from Argentina originally, has been teaching at the State University of New York, SUNY Albany. I think I can announce that she's going to be coming back to Canada to teach. I'm very happy to say, and many of you will know her work on neoliberalism in the state in Argentina. So, with any no further ado,
yeah, escaping Trump land. Okay. Well, when the Argentina situation is. The Argentina situation is somehow different, more contradictory, more complicated at this moment. When I got invited to 3 weeks ago, I was thinking that I had to answer the question about why a guy that like Macri, which is not charismatic at all. He's hardly able to speak, and doesn't absolutely not an attractive figure for anybody, unlike Trump or Bolsonaro, that are awful, but at least can attract people. He's also the son of one of the most powerful domestic transnationalized conglomerates, so the idea that Macri can be somehow connected to little people, somehow connected to regular guys, is absolutely impossible to think. He's also, very clear about that. He's like, he keeps his distance. He never gets in touch with people. He takes vacations in the most luxury resorts everywhere, and all the pictures are him with his super beautiful wife, like resting in the mountains. So it is hard to explain how we got there. But in the 3 weeks, around 3 weeks from when I got invited to come here and today, now the questions changed. Now, it is pretty unlikely that Macri will win the election, which was something that seemed sure like 3 weeks ago. But there are a few months to the election. We still have to wait a few months to the election, so the situation can change a number of times. The presidential election is in October 2019. Before the presidential election in August, there is a mandatory primary, so the mandatory primary somehow sets the condition for the general election, and it is pretty likely that first round of the presidential election won't get anybody elected. The Argentinian electoral system is by direct, so the candidate gets elected and becomes president when they get 50% plus one vote, or when they get more than 40% and the candidate that comes second gets less than 30%. And so this situation seems unlikely now, which means that it's pretty likely that there is going to be a second round. And right today, I don't think Macri is going to win, but and why is that? The situation, economic situation of the country has been deteriorating, but in 2019, it moved to really bad, to borderline catastrophic. Scandals have gone beyond anything that anybody could have imagined. And the support to the government is falling apart without a clear political alternative. So let me recapitulate a little about what happened since Macri got elected in 2015. First of all, the 2015 election was unprecedented in Argentina. For the first time in the in the history of the country, a right-wing coalition wins a clean election, an election without fraud, and also the first time that a right-wing coalition comes to power through an election, actually. Usually in Argentina, during most of 20th century, the right-wing party was the military, the right-wing got power through military coups. So this is the first time that right-wing agendas were implemented by political parties and coalitions that were not clearly right-wing parties. So this was unprecedented. Macri was then the mayor of Buenos Aires city, and he didn't have a particularly successful tenure as a mayor, yet he had a fantastic marketing, marketing by, I don't remember the name, a mercenary that does marketing for whoever pays him. And so his campaign combined arguments about ending poverty, reducing taxes for workers, fighting inflation, resuming growth, which was something that was widely accepted as necessary, but it also raised other arguments about putting an end to the government's hostility to businesses, which was something that was felt during the last years of Cristina Kirchner's government. Fighting corruption, reestablishing the rule of law, recovering the culture of work and individual effort, and this has been repeated a million times, leaving populism behind. This is, I mean, at least in ideological or discursive terms, there is the populist is the bête noire of the right-wing government in Argentina. So this electoral marketing was pretty effective, but there were other factors that explained the election of Mauricio Macri. First, Macri and his party were able to subordinate many right and certain right political groups behind his candidacy, which is something that had not been possible in the previous years, where there were a number of aspirants to political power. Second, there was discontent with the economic slowdown that had been going on in the country since at least 2012. And were seriously restricting Cristina Kirchner's room for expanding public spending to finance social assistance, sustain the purchasing power of wages and consumption, which had been super important in Cristina Kirchner's re-election in 2011. And third, there has been a crisis of legitimacy of progressive policies and progressism in general, which has been now embodied in political forces. I mean, there is something that I would call like some sort of authoritarian neoliberalism from below, for the lack of a better name, a crystallization of, I mean, which is in this case similar probably to the case of Brazil, a crystallization of ideological and political transformations in which large sectors of the population came to reject some emblematic progressive policies, especially the intervention of the state in the reproduction of poor and precarious workers. I mean, the massive cash transfer programs of implemented by the Kirchners. I mean, the idea that I don't want my taxes to be supporting welfare bums has been massive in the country. And also, but also the rejection of progressive policies around sexual rights and reproductive rights. I mean, there is a, in the context of the expansion, the unprecedented expansion of the women's movement and and diverse forms of feminism in the country. And also, and finally, a reaction to memory policies, to an previously unchallenged consensus on the condemnation of human rights violations during the dictatorship. There has been a some sort of exhaustion, or yeah, people getting tired of talking about memory, talking about human rights, talking about the dictatorship. So, yet in 2015, when Macri won the election with a coalition of people that were conservative, but also, I mean, a number of CEOs, people coming, I mean, each ministry at the beginning of Macri's government, each ministry was led by a representative of the sector with which the ministry had to deal. Like, the person who was in charge of agriculture was a person coming for agribusiness corporations. The person who was in the central bank, of course, was somebody that would come from finance. And you could see all these examples, with the exception, of course, of education, where there was a CEO, or I don't remember what company, that didn't have any absolutely no expertise in education, or the or well. So, but because of the nature of this alliance and the nature of the electoral campaign in 2015, it seemed that Macri was expressing a different type, not a traditional conservative reactionary right, that was expressing some sort of modern right, a right that would be neoliberal in his economic program, but also more flexible, more open, more diverse in its political alliances, its political agendas, and especially, I mean, cultural policies. So when Macri took power, immediately, there were two policies that were central to his government. The first one is the government made a decision to liberalize the exchange market, which had been very tightly regulated during the last years of Cristina Kirchner, because of the country's historical limitations to get access to dollars. So in a few weeks, the Argentinian peso lost 30% of its value vis-a-vis the US dollar, which accelerated an already quite high inflation. So Argentina is a country with a long history of very high inflation and hyperinflationary episodes. And devaluations always trigger inflation for reasons that are common to a number of countries of the Global South, countries whose manufacturing depends on are highly dependent on imports, but also for other two reasons that are more specific to Argentina. One is that because of the privatization of public utilities and oil in the 1990s, domestic prices are dollarized. So, which means that when there is a devaluation, the prices of these key sectors of the economy follow the price of the dollar. And the third thing is that the most powerful fractions of the domestic and transnational bourgeoisie are able to transfer the cost of the devaluation to domestic prices. So, and this is especially important in the case of food. Food is following, the prices of food are rising following the depreciation of the Argentinian peso. The other important policy was that Macri took very early in his government was to come to an agreement with a group of holdouts from the default of the early sovereign debt default of the early 2000s. There was this group of Volcker funds that had refused to renegotiate the debt in the 2000s, like most debt holders of Argentinian debt had done during the in 2005 and then again in 2010. And they were sued in Argentina in New York court demanding full payment of these defaulted bonds. Macri immediately accepted this demand, paid this debt in full, and by paying this debt in full, the country got access to international financial markets that had been previously blocked because it was technically in default. So this was a curse in disguise, actually, because the government was able to postpone or somehow soften austerity because it was able to borrow in international markets and it borrowed massively. But on the other hand, we are now sitting on an explosive sovereign debt and facing a debt crisis that is coming kind of pretty soon, probably next year. So the expectation at the beginning of the Macri government was that the neoliberal credentials of the members of the government and the policy shifts would create conditions to attract investments. Also, I mean, other policy shifts were, trade liberalization, the elimination of tariffs on commodity exports, a shift towards the Pacific Alliance and the US, and away from the search for a more autonomous Latin American cooperation of the 2000 and 2010s. So the idea was that this would make the country more attractive for international investors. It didn't happen. We can discuss why it didn't happen. What the government did was to start borrowing massively. So, and massive borrowing in turn helped to avoid extreme austerity and even expand public spending during 2017. So 2016 was a very bad year because of the devaluation, because of very high inflation. 2017 was much better. The GDP stopped falling, salaries also stopped losing purchasing power, poverty somehow fell from the high figures of 2016. And some economic relief combined with the division of the opposition after the electoral defeat of 2016 led to the government party unexpectedly good performance in the 2017 midterm election. The government succeeded in polarizing the election, identifying Cristina Fernández de Kirchner, who was running for Senate, as the leader of the opposition, even though the opposition was highly fragmented. And it appealed to the widespread rejection that Cristina Fernández de Kirchner generated among middle class sectors and also some working class sectors. So the election was a turning point. It seemed that a right-wing force was consolidating with the support of many of those who were negatively affected by its economic policies, in line with other Latin American experiences, Colombia and Chile, probably more than any other country. But the good political scenario of the midterm election that was held in October was gone by December. This is Argentina. So the level, on the one hand, the level of indebtedness started to raise warning for creditors, led to exchange rate instability and the acceleration of inflation. The government responded by raising interest rates that aggravated recession but failed to stabilize the economy. And this was the speculative run against the peso that started in 2017, had a number of episodes during 2018 and is really serious right now in the starting again in February, March 2019. So exchange and macroeconomic instability compounded with political shifts. So as a way to soothe markets, in December 2017, the government passed a law reforming the pension system, but suffered a major political setback. Around a million people demonstrated against this reform. This demonstration, in turn, was the object of severe repression, and this was a turning point. This was the end of the massive approval of Mauricio Macri's and his government. And because of this, the government has been postponing the parliamentary discussion of labor reform. But the political limitations of the Macri's agenda raised warnings among banks and creditors, well, sovereign debt was getting out of control. So that's how there were a succession of episodes of financial instability in 2018, where the Argentinian government started to lose control of the economy. When this happened, a number of right-wing think tanks and economists were arguing that the problem was that the government was unwilling to implement the type of shock policies that were necessary to stabilize the economy and to drastically reduce public spending of pensions, social assistance, and state personnel. They expressed the view that of markets that Macri is politically unable to do what he is supposed to do or what he came to do. And some government officials would agree with this, but some of them are morons, some of them are not so moronic and are aware of the political problems inherent to eliminate, for instance, massive social assistance programs. So they are between rock and hard place. So it was in this context that the government signed an agreement with the IMF. The agreement with the IMF somehow tied the hands of the government and gave the government more room to implement austerity policies. And I mean, I don't have time to go into the details of this agreement, but one interesting feature of the agreement with the IMF, or two, sorry, one is that it is probably the largest loan in the history of the IMF. The other thing is that most disbursements were in 2018 and in the first month of 2019 before the election. After the election, the country will have to start paying back this loan without new disbursements. So, on the other hand, 2018 was a year of intense social mobilization. Women, informal workers, shantytown dwellers, human rights organizations started to organize unprecedented massive demonstrations. In many cases, despite the conciliatory position of movement leadership, and in general, without a clear political leadership, repression also became a lot more intense. So the deterioration of the economic situation intensified in 2019, but the political scenario is now dominated by the incoming presidential election. So many who were motorizing struggles in 2018 are now negotiating the building of opposition alliances and candidacies. So Macri announced his intention to run for re-election. Polls are now showing that the approval of his government is the lowest since he was elected, and his electoral campaign is not making promises about a better future. On the contrary, they are talking about the need to make sacrifices, about the need to learn to moderate our expectations. And they have been also presenting themselves as the opposition of the opposition. They are playing with the fear of a return to the populism, to the past, to the whole history of populism, in which they say, well, it's 70 years of populism, which includes all the dictatorships that led the country to this catastrophic state. So we are the only warranty that this is not coming back. On the other hand, there is, as I said before, there is a real possibility that Macri loses the election, which was unthinkable just a few months ago. So members of the political coalition that supported Macri are thinking about turning to the opposition. The mainstream media that had silenced any criticism to Macri in the last years is now being very critical of him. Yes, I'm wrapping up. But the opposition is also in a very complicated situation. Cristina Kirchner, who is the one who would obtain the largest quantity of votes, is also very resisted by many within the opposition and many voters, and may even be unable to run if some of the many lawsuits against her are successful and send her to jail. In the last few weeks, a more moderate candidate has emerged and is trying to find the golden middle between the radical populism of Cristina Kirchner and the policy mistakes of Macri. This faces a number of problems. It requires, first, that the bourgeoisie accepts to make some concessions, which hasn't happened recently, to satisfy demands of subaltern groups. And second, it has to be able to manage the mobilization capacity of these subordinate groups and subordinate them to a sensible government agenda. I am finishing. So the broader political prospects are really, really complicated. Political representation and the legitimacy of politics are have been in crisis for a while. One of the consequences is that social mobilization has been massive, but unable to have political expressions. On the other hand, the crisis of politics has created also conditions for an authoritarian turn or for an intensification of authoritarianism. But this is probably, unlike the case of Brazil, still an open dispute in Argentina. And if the result will depend on a number of things. One is the economic prospects that don't look good at all. The other thing is that the progressive forces, the left, social movements, had to address a couple of very, very serious problems. One is the economic agenda. The international and domestic situation are really difficult. The kind of progressive economic agenda of the early 2000s is now impossible. And then there is something else. Social movements that have been united in the repudiation of government economic policies are divided in regards with other struggles, and especially with feminism that has been super important in the feminist agenda that have been super important in the last years in the country. Abortion divides social movements, and I don't know how we are going to solve this. So these limitations combined with widespread social frustration, with the deterioration of the economic situation, is also the breeding ground for the consolidation and radicalization of this neoliberal authoritarianism. But Argentinian politics has always been extremely dynamic and unpredictable. So I will finish with this.